holding firm to the Quran and the Sunnah. As we mentioned in the beginning, there's no way that you can purify yourself other than the Quran and Sunnah. Allah is your creator, He knows. The best purifier of the soul in action, the Prophet ﷺ. So when you want to find something that's from the Sunnah, you know it's going to help you. The adhkar, the dhikr you make, the thing, that's the way you need to purify yourself. I met a man one time in Sudan, actually a family member. He told me that I am from this tariqah. He follows a certain sheikh, super sheikh. And they do certain ways of dhikr and things like this. So I like to look at myself as somebody who's open-minded. I like to hear from other people. You know, I'm not somebody who's going to say, you know, let me hear from you, okay? So he said to me, I'm going to explain to you what we do. He said, we have something called the wazifa. You heard the wazifa? It's actually a job or a duty. He said, we have a duty that we do every day after Maghrib, certain dhikrs that we make. I said, okay, let me hear it. He said to me, we say la ilaha illallah, you know, 100 times. We say la ilaha wahdahu la sharika lahu al-mulku wa lahu al-hamdu huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir 100 times. I said, that's excellent. It's all from the sunnah. He said, but this one, you're not going to understand. So what I'm about to tell you right now, you're not going to understand. And he starts to break some down. Shuka, uka, buka, ooh, something. I looked at him, I said, look, man, I said, I speak two languages, Arabic and English, and you only speak one, that's Arabic. So I said, I don't understand that, and I said, there's no way you understand it either. That's like some jinn language, like you're calling on the jinn or something like this. A'udhu billah, what is this, man? He's like, no, the sheikh told us it's a good thing to say. I said, no, obviously it's not. If it was a good thing to say, who would have said it before your sheikh? The Prophet ﷺ. This is where we have to put the scale for our, we want to purify ourselves, look at our actions, we have a scale, we put it in. And we forget about the scale. The scholars talked about it. For an action to be accepted, how many conditions must be met?
Two
conditions. First is the ikhlas, the intention. And the second one is
sunnah.
The sunnah, in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So with any action we put into the scale, I want to purify myself now, right? Is this, he has good ikhlas maybe. The guy, he could have ikhlas. Don't think because somebody who fell in innovation doesn't have ikhlas. No, he could be sincere in what he's doing. But he just did it in the wrong way. So he said, no, it won't be accepted. Or if somebody does something that's in the sunnah, but he's doing it out of riyah, so people see him, obviously it's not going to be accepted as well. Several examples. Have you ever, who's been to Turkey before? Have you ever seen the twirling dervish? Seriously, have you guys ever seen it?
Seen it?
Yeah, if you can go to YouTube and you try turning dervish, it's there. Originally, now it's become a tourist attraction, but they say they're doing ibadah. They have these long hats, tasasili mashallah, and they have like this cape that goes down, and they spin around like this on their heel. I'm not going to do it, probably fall or something, you know, but they spin around like this. I don't know how they don't get dizzy. They spin like this. And they say, what are you doing? They say, we're making dhikr. Who taught you this? Another super sheikh. Okay? So they're making dhikr. They're making dhikr like this. What's in his heart? Allahu A'lam. He could have ikhlas. But did the Prophet ﷺ and the companions make dhikr like this? So is it accepted? No. Is it going to really purify us? No. Even if you think it's sometimes, you know, some people think like this funky stuff and it's weird. No, it's the shaitan making you feel like this. It can't really, really purify you. For example, now you have the whores. You know who the whores are? The who guys. When they make the dhikr, they've started off saying, La ilaha illallah. And they had ikhlas, inshallah. Allahu A'lam, they had ikhlas. Making, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah. Okay, mashallah. Then their big sheikh came to their small sheikh. And the big sheikh is named Iblis. Came to him, he tapped him on the shoulder. He said, look, man, he said, what if you were to say, La ilaha, and you die? There's no God. There's no ilah, and then you die. You die on kufr, a'udhu billah. The guy was like, you know, that's a good point. That's a valid point there. I could die on kufr if I don't finish the shahada. He says, let's just take it to Allahu, Allahu, make it shorter. He's like, thanks for the advice. So he tells his people, his followers, instead of la ilaha illallah, we're just gonna say Allahu, Allahu. And then at the end, but this is correct? If you were to die, would you go to, as people are scared now, would you go to hellfire? You say no. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, Man kana akhira kalamuhu min ad-dunya. His last words are, La ilaha illallah. He went to the Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we go back to the issue of aqidah again, the belief. Allah describes himself as Rahim, Ra'uf, Kareem, Latif, Mannan. You think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're trying to say the shahada, you don't get up, he's going to say, oh, you doubt, he's going to hold us accountable for this? No, no way in the world Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold us accountable for this. It's from shaitan, the tricks of shaitan. So they start saying, Allahu, Allahu. A little bit later he says, you know what? We can make even more dhikr. We can speed it up. Do a turbo session. Because we have huwa. And if you stop on the huwa and you take off the fatha on the well, who? So how many of these could we say in a session? Let's be honest. You could say more, couldn't you? Who? Have you guys seen that? You seen them before? And then they created something from the sibha with the 100 beads. They have what they call the alfiyya. You know the alfiyya? It's the 1,000 beads. This, if you do it properly, if you know what you're doing, if you're not like you guys, you don't know what you're doing. It's the special way of doing it. You don't do one, two. Actually, you pull it like this. You just keep pulling it and you, whoo. And they're dancing around, they're going crazy, and they're having fun, having a good time. Well, like the intention could have been good. But once again, we have to go back, we have to be honest. If we're going to be successful as an ummah, and all of our aspects, we have to look at, did the Prophet ﷺ make dhikr like this? Did he do it in this way? Did the companions do it? If it was good, they would have done it like this. But obviously, it's not going to be something, and it's not going to help you perfectly. At the end, it's not going to work. It doesn't work. If it doesn't have ikhlas, it doesn't have following the sunnah, it's not going to work. So you're not going to purify yourself in this way. A lot of people sometimes, and when I mention this at the end, and in the ways that it comes from this, what we found our forefathers doing, our families doing. So this is Islam. This is my version of Islam. My forefathers did it like this, so I'm going to do it like this. But if it's not in accordance to the sunnah, it's not going to be accepted. It's not going to purify you. And anything you want to do, you need to go straight to the source.
Please like, share, and subscribe to the Digital Minbar YouTube channel and hit the notification bell. Please also like, share, and subscribe to our Facebook and Twitter. Links in the description of this video.